And we certainly are no different with our community conference, having to adjust and hold our conference virtual so that we can share many different opportunities and those kinds of things with you. At this time, I would like to call on Mr. Jesse Jacobs, who is a member of the United Tribes Board representing Metrolina Native American Association, and he is going to introduce Dr. Christopher Webb for us. Mr. Jesse?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Before we have our invocation, I would like to introduce Dr. Christopher Webb. He's the senior pastor of New Bethel Baptist Church in Clinton, North Carolina. He's a proud member of the Waccamaw Siouan Tribe in North Carolina. He resides in the Coharie country. Good country. He's been serving in the ministry since 1998 and has been in full-time vocational ministry since 2001. He served as pastor in three other churches within the Burnt Swamp Baptist Association. He has been married to his loving and supportive wife, Carmella, since 1992, and they have three lovely children. And now, if you would, please, Dr. Webb, to lead us in a prayer.
Right, Mr. Jesse, thank you for this opportunity to take part in this session. And we will go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Let us pray. Holy Father, it is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, that we honor you on this day as we have assembled for our 2021 North Carolina Indian Unity Conference. It is with deep reverence and retrospect that we acknowledge your bountiful blessings. Heavenly Father, we pause right now to offer our praise with a deep sense of gratitude for the strong roots we have during these changing times. However, we stand by your grace and your mercy upon the strong roots we have as an Indian people from each community we all represent and are a part of. We acknowledge right now, as a result of us being here on this grand occasion, it is through and by our forefathers who all paved the way literally through their blood, sweat, and tears. We praise you, Holy Father, for them all. As we take this moment to acknowledge you, Father, we ask for your divine will, guidance, purpose, power, and beautiful blessings upon this grand assembly of our Indian Unity Conference. We alone by ourselves are nothing without you. Therefore, right now, we repent of our sins and we humbly pray, just as you have taught us, we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And we pray this prayer in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Dr. Webb. Thank you so much. Our speakers today, as well as our panelists, are going to further highlight our theme, Strong Roots in These Changing Times. And we have three guest speakers with us today. And I'm going to start off with Chief Brucey Ogletree, and she is the chief of the Halliwell Saponi Tribe, located in Holliston, North Carolina. So welcome, Chief Ogletree.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to say good afternoon to everyone. And as Ms. Gwen said, I am Ogletree Richardson, Chief of the Halliwell Saponi Indian Tribe. It is truly an honor to be able to speak to you all this afternoon. And first, I'd like to say thank you to everyone who played a role in helping me to have this opportunity. As I gave some thought as to what I wanted to share today, I thought, well, how appropriate the theme that was chosen for the 46th annual North Carolina Indian Unity Conference. So as I gave additional thought to this theme, I thought to address it and how it relates to our tribal nations and the title of Changing Strong Roots in Changing Times, I concluded that perhaps I needed to talk a little bit about my own tribe, the Halawasaponi Indian tribe, tribal identity, our COVID efforts, our survival, and how we have continued to stay connected with other tribal nations on the state and national levels, and going forward, how we plan to maintain our strong roots in changing times. The Halawasaponi Indian tribe is located in the northeastern part of North Carolina. We're located in Halifax and Warren counties. We have over 4,300 enrolled tribal members, and our tribal government has an 11-member council, and that includes the chief and vice chief. Our tribe was recognized by the state of North Carolina on April 15, 1965. We hold our annual powwow on the third weekend in April each year to celebrate our state recognition. We have the oldest and largest powwow in the state of North Carolina, and we have had over 10,000 people attend our powwow. The next thing I want to talk about has to do with COVID-19 in our tribal community. Sadly, we lost some of our tribal citizens to COVID-19. Some of our people tested positive and suffered devastating effects, while others who tested positive only had to quarantine. However, throughout this pandemic, our tribal citizens supported each other, especially those who were affected. And while many of us know that sometimes when major events such as a pandemic might occur, such changes have caused our people to work harder to survive and maintain our identity. Also, our past experience has taught us that often our people are not identified or misidentified as American Indian. Therefore, during the early stage of coronavirus testing, we were vigilant about how our tribal citizens were being identified. Since a majority of our people live in Halifax and Warren counties, I contacted the health department directors in each county. I found that there was a difference in how our people were being registered. When I received my first coronavirus test, I learned that I had not been identified at all on paper. Another citizen, some others, they were identified, but they were not listed as American Indian. Needless to say, those records were corrected. Fortunately, when I received my first vaccination, I received a form that allowed me to identify myself as a Halawasaponi Indian. And now I just want to share a few things with you that we have been doing in our tribal community during the pandemic. We were able to offer testing and a vaccination site on our tribal properties. The testing site was a drive-through event located at our tribal government office, which resulted in over 200 people being tested. The vaccination site was held on our tribal powwow grounds, and that resulted in 650 people receiving the Moderna vaccine. At the vaccine site, the staff distributed masks and hand sanitizer to the participants. These events were all the result of our staff working with the health department and the rural health group. Other COVID events that we've offered, they have included a drive-through. There've been drive-throughs such as giveaways of food, masks, hand sanitizer, and gift cards. The staff, tribal council, and tribal volunteers work diligently to provide these opportunities to our community. To make these events happen, several providers and suppliers were sought, and we received many donated items for distribution. In addition, our school staff, the Halawasapony Tribal School staff, provided a drive-through food giveaway. To obtain vaccinations for the school staff, help was provided by the local health department. To speak briefly about our survival, traditionally, tribes have always had strong roots and maintained deep ties in the midst of changing times. However, we all know COVID has certainly made a change in that for us. Nevertheless, today we're able to show that we are resilient and can come together as tribal nations to share our rich history, customs, and wisdom about our American Indian culture and heritage. And all of this is done through a virtual setting that we have not experienced before. As I took a look at our connections here in North Carolina, we are grateful for such agencies as the North Carolina Commission of Indian Affairs. With all of the representation that we have from the 8 tribes and the urban organizations, this is a great vehicle that helps our people to stay connected. Along the same line, I've taken a look at the United Tribes of North Carolina. That's another great organization that provides greater coordination and unity among our Indian tribes in North Carolina. And certainly it is to be commended for helping to keep our tribal nations together by holding an annual conference. As I noted earlier about our tribal connections in North Carolina, we have also maintained our connections with other tribes throughout the United States and the Alaska Natives. These connections are made by supporting virtual conferences and events, powwows, and things of that sort. As tribal nations in North Carolina, we are proud to showcase our heritage as survivors throughout history. Our connections to tribal nations in other parts of the country remain at a high because we continue to maintain our contact and we collaborate through ever-changing avenues of communication, including virtual meetings at the local, state, and national levels. Thus, we know we have strong roots and changing times. I also truly believe that through our work with our own tribe, our connection with other tribal nations, and holding on to what our ancestors passed on to us are the reasons we have strong roots and changing times. Over the years, as we witnessed changes, many things and values in the lives of our tribal people remain the same. For instance, it still holds true that we know what is best for our people, and we know what our ancestors passed on to us. Yes, today we can proudly say that we have maintained our strong roots in changing times. However, let us not forget our youth, the seventh generation, to carry on these traditions for the survival of our tribal nations. Furthermore, we must be attentive to the terms used to identify our tribal citizens, such as American Indian and Native American, or if our people are being identified at all. If we are not observant today, 100 years down the road, no one will know who we really are, nor will anyone know anything about our strong roots and changing times. So in closing, I want to say to everyone, let us remember to stay connected, maintain our tribal ties, be vigilant for our identity, and share our history. We are American Indians, and we know what's best for our people. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak to you today. And just as we have stated, this is the 46th annual North Carolina Indian Unity Conference. So the proof is here today that we have strong roots and changing times. Thank you all. You have been a great audience.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Chief Aglatry. Wonderful, wonderful words. Our next guest speaker today is Mrs. Melissa Singler, and she's currently serving as the sixth president of Robinson Community College. And she's currently serving as my boss as well. Prior to joining RCC, she served as the executive vice president for Cape Fear Community College. She has extensive experience in leading, organizing, facilitating, and evaluating the academics and operations of higher education. She values the importance of understanding unique organizational cultures and working collaboratively to move forward in equitable and innovative ways. She is an advocate for community college access, student success, and workforce development. In addition to her experience in higher education, she holds a wealth of corporate experience. Earlier in her career, she served as an assistant vice president for United Carolina Bank and as vice president for First Citizens Bank, and as a teacher and assistant principal for Columbus County Schools. President Melissa Singler holds a master's degree in school administration and a Bachelor of Arts degree in middle grades education, both from UNC Wilmington. She is the daughter of Harold and Elaine Jacobs from the Buckhead community and a member of the Waccamaw Siouan tribe. She and her husband, Michael, reside in Lumberton, North Carolina, and they have two adult children and three grandchildren. Welcome, President Singler.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everyone. I am so excited to be here. I bring you greetings on behalf of our Board of Trustees, our faculty, staff, and administration. And I'm honored to speak here today amongst family, friends, and colleagues. As president of a North Carolina Community College, I see my job as helping to ground not only young people, but anyone in need of an anchor in who they are and where they want to go in life. Recently, someone asked me what it's like being an administrator at a predominantly American Indian college. I actually get that question quite a bit. And I always explain that American Indian students are just like any other young people. They have dreams and aspirations. They cherish their families, friends, and loved ones. They want to succeed in school and beyond and compete globally. And if they've made it onto our campus, or any campus for that matter, It's evident that they are proud of their heritage and already possess the tools to prosper. These students are on their way to achieving their goals, and I'm proud to be a part of their journey. But what about our young people who are not equipped with the necessary tools to thrive, who may feel confused, angry, and lost? Worse, they adopt the idea that our culture is of little to no value, and while they may say they are proud to be Indian, they don't really know what that means. How do we help those young people, or it's not always young people, but how do we help them to find the path? How do we help them tap into the strength and resiliency that is such a large part of our culture? A few weeks ago, my oldest grandson, Aiden, was trying to build something out of blocks, sticks, Legos, Lincoln Logs. He basically had every building material available that was appropriate for a seven-year-old. I watched him repeatedly try and fail to stand up this wall. It just kept falling on him. After about five attempts, he stood up, kicked his project across the floor, and pronounced, "I quit." I called him over, asked him why he stopped trying. He said, "Grandma, I just can't do this. I can't do this. I quit." Those words took me back more than a few years ago, growing up in Buckhead and living beside Grandma Mazur and Papa Ed. Now, some of you may remember them, but I grew up in the house right beside them. Whenever they heard one of us say, "I can't," they stopped us in our tracks and reminded us of who we are and where we came from, and that indeed we could do whatever we thought we couldn't do because it's in your blood. Those words came back to me as I was speaking with my grandson. And so I started telling him stories about his great-grandfather, Harold Jacobs, who was my father, and his great-great Uncle David Young, who were master carpenters and often spent time building together. I shared stories with Aiden, and thanks to the internet, some pictures of the houses, churches, and buildings that they worked on together over the years. Some of the stories were stories my dad used to tell us about some of his more unique experiences, and generally centered around how he fixed something somebody else messed up. He loved to tell those stories. And some were stories that I witnessed because we had to work with him during the summers when we weren't working on the farm with Grandma and Granddaddy. After sharing these stories with Aiden and answering a few dozen of his questions about his Grandpa Harold, who unfortunately he never got the chance to meet, and Uncle David, I finally said to him, "Son, you can build whatever you want. It's in your blood." His chest expanded and he walked over to the pile of things that he had kicked, the building materials he had kicked away, and he started again. I could tell by his intensity that he was determined to finish this time, and he did. As a matter of fact, my mom, Elaine Jacobs, his great-grandmother, looked at everything he had done and said, "Son, that looks so good. I'm proud of you, and Papa Harold would be proud of you too." To which Aiden replied, "Thanks, Grandma Elaine. You know it's in my blood." Now, I need to define here what I mean by blood. My granddaughter is not my biological granddaughter, but because she's been raised in our community with our stories and our history, it's also in her blood. Grounding young people in who they are and where they come from is a positive approach to building their self-confidence and sense of identity. It can also be an important intervention that can bring new perspectives and centering for youth who are facing challenges. We have to remind them of who they are, where they come from, and let them know that they can succeed. It's in their blood. It's their birthright. They have the skill set. They have the potential to learn the skill set. Aiden's new sense of pride and confidence was instilled in him by those stories I shared about my dad, his great-grandfather, and my great uncle David, who was his great great uncle. It was simply a lesson in family and cultural awareness. So what does this have to do with helping young people find a path and tap into the strength and resiliency that is such a large part of our culture? Cultural consciousness and responsiveness must be an ongoing, deliberate, and intentional effort, and it must take root across the spectrum, and not only education, but at the community level, the faith-based level. We have to reach families who, for whatever reasons, have become marginalized. Even at 7 years of age, I already know that Aiden enjoys working with his hands, loves to be outside, and like his great-grandpa, has a natural talent for building things. There are many Aidens in our communities, individuals with natural gifts and talents, but have found themselves at one time discouraged, defeated, disparaged, who have made the choice to quit because they didn't have someone to teach them or remind them that they can do this because it's in their blood. They didn't realize their ability to tear down a motor or rebuild a lawnmower engine was a skill set that could help them to excel in the automotive or engine repair industry one day. They don't understand their natural affinity for playing those video games could be the key for a very successful future in simulation and game development or robotics. I'm going to share something with you that a lot of people don't know. I dropped out of high school at the age of 16. Back then, parental consent was not required, and I didn't ask anybody, I just did it. Thankfully, my parents and elders, grandparents and others, loved me enough to remind me of who I am, where I came from. Now, I'm not going to get into the specifics of how I got reminded that day, but needless to say, I've never forgotten it. But not only, they reminded me not only of who I am and where I came from, but I had the ability to succeed because it was in my blood. I immediately enrolled within weeks in community college. I earned my GED and eventually completed my bachelor's and my master's degree. Now, this story doesn't end here as it's still being written, but one thing I know beyond a shadow of any doubt, the ability to succeed was always in my blood, as it is in those of every one of our people. But we've got to keep telling those stories, and we've got to keep reminding our young people that they're warriors, they're princesses, they can do whatever it is they desire to do. They have the history to do that. In closing, I want to thank you for your time today. I know that I didn't speak a great deal about what the community college has to offer, so I'm going to take just a moment to tell you that if you have not met with your local community college, there are 58 community colleges in North Carolina. If you have not met with your local community college, please take the time to do that. There are classes available to high school students that will allow our young people to graduate from high school work ready. And these classes are of no charge. They can graduate with an associate's degree or with certifications that allow them to go directly into the workforce. If you need help navigating that, please feel free to reach out to me, no matter where you live, and I'll be glad to put you in touch with the people you need to talk to. Again, thank you for your time today. Please keep our community, our college, and our nation in your prayers. And remember the three W's and to find your spot and get a shot. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Singer. Your words are so inspirational. I could just sit all day and listen. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Chief Michael Jacobs, Pastor Michael Jacobs. I got the pleasure of meeting him at the Unity Conference, I think it was last year. or year before last, and he is absolutely dynamic. He's the second oldest son of the late Martin Eddie Jacobs Sr. and Magdalene Baldwin Jacobs, both of the Waccamaw Suwan community. He was born and raised in Buckhead, and not long after graduating high school, he accepted the Lord as his personal savior, and soon after, he announced his calling to the ministry. Before coming to Mount Sinai Holiness Church, President Mike pastored Union Chapel Church in Brunswick County for several years. And of course, he ended up coming back home. On August the 22nd, 2003, Pastor Jacobs was voted in as pastor of Mount Sinai Holiness Church, which located in the Buckhead community. And actually, that's the church he grew up in. He has served on the Waccamaw Suwan Tribal Council, holding the position of tribal co-chair and chairman. He currently holds the position of tribal chief of the Waccamaw Suwan tribe, as well as one of the two representatives for the North Carolina Commission of Indian Affairs. He's part owner and president of Eddie's Truck Leasing Company, which was founded by his mother and father. And he has also won the Economic Advancement of Native American People Award from United Tribes of North Carolina. One thing to be said is no matter what the preacher is doing, whether it's playing basketball with the youth or discussing tribal or community issues, he always carries himself as a man of God, showing others that he is nothing but a man who is an instrument for the Lord, who allows God to lead and guide him in every way in everything he does. Please let's welcome Pastor Chief Michael Jacobs.
Good evening. It's an honor and a privilege to be able to join on this Unity Conference virtual program today. I am humbled to have this opportunity from the United Tribes and all those involved who have asked me to speak on our land acknowledgement and the Unity Charge today. I think about, most of all, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the faith of our people, and how it has made us resilient. You know, when you think about where we come from and how many battles and storms we faced, it really encourages our heart to know that this COVID situation and other things about us, it's just another storm, another battle, that the Creator also will bring us through if we'll maintain and hold faith. But I want to share with us today, when we think of land acknowledgement, the earth is our mother. And the Creator made you and I, created us from the very earth around us and everything about us. You know, the Creator shared that creation story within us. And I look at the trees and the blades of grass and the wind that blows. And it oftentimes, you know, as a Native American, you know, it encourages my heart to know that we have a purpose in this life. We weren't made or created useless, but everything that was made with a purpose and a promise. And we have a right to this land. The land is not ours to own. You know, Native people have never believed in deedship and ownership, but to live is a right given to us by the Creator. And I think about, where I live there at the house, there's an oak tree, a live oak in the yard. It's estimated over 350 years old. The live oak comes from one of the smallest acres, the smallest seed in the tree family. But this tree has seen a many of storms. It's endured a many of changes around it, but yet it still stands. I look up to the branches of that tree, you know, and you would think maybe the big branches and all the limbs that we see with the natural eye is what makes it great. Or you would think it was the ever-changing leaves that continue to stay green no matter the season that makes it great. But when you look at that tree, its strength comes from its roots, from what it's tied to, from that that's holding it up. And we're all, as Native people, are being held up by our ancestors, our ties to the land, our ties to each other, our ties to the future, not with boundaries of ownership or titles, but spiritually connected, that we can grow and encourage one another in these changing times. As I was listening to President Missy, giving the account of our grandparents and how that we have come through hard times and accepting one another because they would encourage us. we all as Native people share that raising in our homes, but we don't need to stop now. We need to continue on sharing with our youth that they have a purpose, that they've been brought forth into this land for a reason. And that reason is to caretake, you know, for Mother Earth, to caretake for one another, to look out for all of our kindred, whether they be a Native American, black, white, yellow, whatever their color. We're all created from the same earth. I would like to share a story on yesterday. We were called out, Station 4, our fire department, to a tragic scene. We had a house fire in a neighboring community, and the family lost everything they had. And on my mind, as I was thinking on today and what I wanted to share and what I felt the Lord would have me to say, I looked around that scene, and there was firemen from all different stations, all different races, all different people. But we all fought that fire just like it was our house, just like we owned the belongings that was within it. We didn't worry about where we come from or what truck we drove or what station we belonged to, but we all came together for a common cause. And we were able to overcome those flames, even though the family lost the majority of what they had. There was still a spirit of unity at that scene of tragedy. And it just encouraged my heart to know that that's the nation of natives that we come from. And that's the nation that we want to share with this United States, that we are a people of togetherness because we come from the same place. We recognize our origin and creative purpose in life. It excites me when I think about all the things that we have overcome. And yet and still, even though our future right now, it seems uncertain. Don't know exactly what we're going to face ahead, but I know we're going to face it together. This virtual meeting today, I'm more nervous today than I've ever been in my life sitting in front of this computer. But I know spiritually we're all together within our hearts. And this is what matters most of all, is that we'll remain together. We'll overcome separation. We'll overcome, even when it comes to our tribes. I'm not just a walk-along. Man, I'm Native. And being Native, it makes me kinship to the Halawa, to the Kahari, to the Lumbee, to all the other tribes in this state and across this United States. We're all blood of one blood. And until we achieve the fact that we can overcome any obstacle together, until we achieve the thinking and the mindset to attack the goals, then oftentimes the enemies are going to tear us down. And some of those enemies today are mental health problems, drug problems, our youth being so disencouraged during these times of trials. But we can overcome it together if we would just learn to exalt, to encourage one another, to recognize one another's differences, and realize that by recognizing our differences, we're made strong when we accept them and encourage one another. I'm just so humbled to be a part of my extended family today, my extended community. As I look at this Unity Conference, the United Tribes, the Commission, and all of these different organizations, our local tribal governments, all of these are ways that we as Native people can reach out and extend the traditions and the teaching that we've achieved as young people, that we can share it with this great world around us. We were green before green was cool. Native Americans have always loved this land, and folks, we're going to continue to love this land. We have military boys and girls that are dying for the love of this land. Yes, it's important to me. It's important to us all. But let's live important. Let's show one another that we're important together, and we can make this trip. Folks, as I think about that great oak tree and all the storms it faced, it's still standing today. And if the Lord should tarry generations to come, it'll probably still be standing. But it's got a right to exist. You and I, we have a right to live, love, and thrive as Native American people. So I charge you, this Unity Conference, grab all the information and all the knowledge you can get. Let it be fuel to your soul. Let it be an encouragement to your heart that the Creator planned before each and every one of us a path that we must walk, and that we'll walk it in faith and hope and love, knowing that we were made with a purpose. I thank each and every one of you. And again, remember me in prayer, and I'll be praying for y'all that God will continue to bless us, that we'll be a united people, and that we'll be a united tribe, that no matter what the storm, what the situation may be, that we'll be brothers and sisters together. May God bless you.
Thank you so much, Pastor Mike. One of the things that I heard in all three of our speakers' messages was resiliency. And I think they both, all three, so eloquently shared that with us, is that we are a resilient people. And I like really what Preacher Mike said, that, you know, yes, we're all from the 8 tribes, 4 urban organizations, but we're all Native. And that's what makes us so resilient. So thank you all three for sharing all those words of wisdom with us. We're a little early before our panel discussion. So if you want to take maybe about a 3-minute break, just a 3-minute break, and we'll come back on and get started with our panel discussion. Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started a few minutes early. I think our panelists are here, and I'm sure they're anxious to share with you. Are we ready, Dr. Lampley?
Yes, ma'am. Everyone's here. We're ready to go.
Okay. I'm going to first of all introduce our panelists for today, and I'm going to start with Dr. Connie Locklear. Dr. Connie Locklear is the director of the Title VI Indian Education Program for the public schools of Robeson County, North Carolina. Dr. Locklear has spent her entire professional career in education. She has taught middle school, high school, and college level mathematics. Dr. Locklear has served in many capacities. She has worked as a school-based curriculum specialist and a district-wide curriculum supervisor in the areas of mathematics and science. Dr. Locklear also spent many years working with the North Carolina Teacher Academy, where she provided professional development opportunities to teachers across the state. She has provided professional development at the local, regional, state, national, and at the international level, where she has had the honor to present at the World's Indigenous Peoples Conference in 2014. Dr. Locklear holds a bachelor's and master's degree in mathematics education, as well as an educational specialist and doctorate of education degree in curriculum and instruction. She's also served in many different capacities as the chairperson of the Burroughs Welcome Fund Student Service Enrichment Program, an appointed member of the North Carolina General Assembly for the Professional Educator Preparation and Standards Commission, the first vice president for the National Indian Education Board of Directors. She's also served as a member of the North Carolina Science, Mathematics, and Technology Education Center Board, member of the Intertribal Talking Circle Substance Abuse Prevention Native Youth Community Partnership Grant, and a member of the UNC Pembroke First American Teacher Education Advisory Board, and former chairperson of the State Advisory Council on Indian Education. Our next guest panelist is Zoe, and Zoe is from Clinton, North Carolina, and she is a member of the Kahari Tribe. Zoe is a senior at Clinton High School and a student ambassador in the North Carolina School of Science and Mathematics online program. She is the student body president at Clinton High School, president of the Clinton High School Native American Student Organization, secretary of the North Carolina Native American Youth Organization, and a member of the Native American Students Club at the North Carolina School of Science and Mathematics. And our last but not least panelist is Joshua Richardson. Joshua is from the Hollister community and a citizen of the Halawasaponi Indian Tribe. He received his Juris Doctorate with highest honors from North Carolina Central University School of Law. He's currently an associate attorney for Buckley LLP, and he serves as an ex officio member of the North Carolina Commission of Indian Affairs as the North Carolina Native American Council on Higher Education representative. As an advocate for the rights of Indigenous peoples and a rising scholar in tribal and federal Indian law, he was recently appointed to serve as the first legal counsel for the Halawasaponi Indian Tribe on a pro bono basis. Currently, Joshua is pursuing his Master of Laws in Indigenous Peoples Law from the University of Oklahoma to further his endeavors and passion to advocate for all tribal nations. Let's warm welcome to all three of our panelists today. And I will be asking some questions, and they are going to share with you their answers or their visions for these questions. No particular order, whoever wants to chime in first. Our first question is, our theme this year is strong roots in changing times. What strong roots have you seen emerge in these changing times?
Hi, this is Connie. I want to first begin by acknowledging the land of our 8 state recognized tribes, our Kohari tribe, Western Band of Cherokee, the Halawasa Pony, the Lumbee, the Meherrin, the Saponi, the Ochanichi Band of Saponi Nations, Waccamaw Suan, as well as all of our indigenous populations that are gathered here with us today on this virtual platform. I would also like to pay respect to our elders from the past, present, and future. May we always be mindful of the path that our elders have paved so that each of us can be where we are today, and may we never forget our connection to the land. I am going to say a lot of what's already been said. I jotted down some notes, and as Dr. Richardson and Ms. Singler and Preacher Jacobs was speaking, I thought, well, there's my presentation. But there's one other thing I'd like to share with you, and I'm going to share my screen just a minute before I talk. And if you don't mind, but this is going back to what, this goes right back to what Ms. Singler said. And as I share this screen, all of the information that you heard about me was stuff. And I want to share this with you. Those are just things that God has blessed me with, and he's given me the opportunity to accomplish. But this really defines me. And that's why I wanted to share that with you. I always send that, all that stuff, and I always go back to this piece because these are my roots. These are my strong roots in changing times. This is my family, my husband, who is my world, and my son and his wife, who is my second daughter, Whitney, and my grandson, Ezekiel, my daughter, who is my best friend, and her husband, who's my second son, Christopher, and their two grandchildren, Izzy and Eli. These are my roots. These are my parents. And the reason it's so important for me to just spend a little bit of time talking about them is all that stuff you heard about me stem from these two individuals. Neither of my parents graduated from high school. I'm the first person in my family to graduate from high school and from college. And so that's huge. But what I want to talk to you a little bit about, and I'm going to go back to the original screen, stop sharing for a minute, is resiliency. That was the one word that I put down also. And we heard that from the other three presenters also. We are resilient. We have proven this time and time again. And we've also shown that we've been able to adapt to changing times. These have been very difficult. Another thing I would like to share is the sense of community that has come out of this. My husband and I both have COVID back in December, and it was right after Christmas we were diagnosed with COVID. My husband was very sick. I was sick, but he was like really sick. His fever was 107. And then my daughter and her family who lives next door was diagnosed with COVID also, so they couldn't go anywhere. But we had people, our church families, different community people calling and bringing stuff and putting it on the porch. And, you know, I would call and say, I need you to pick up my medicine. And I'd put the money in an envelope and I'd go out there and the money would still be in the chair and envelope on the porch. So that sense of community that I have seen during this time, we've also, the importance of family. You know, relationships are so powerful for Native people, and we're used to gathering grandma's and grandpa's house and aunts and uncles and everybody to come together on Sunday, and we haven't been able to do that. And so, but what we have done is that our immediate family, we've been able to just spend more time and value that. And I think the other thing that has really come out of COVID during this is our spirituality, our relationship with God. We realize everything is dependent upon Creator God. He is the one, as Preacher Jacob said earlier, that's where we get our hope from, that's where our faith comes from. That's where our strong roots come from. When my husband was so sick with COVID and there was no one in the home for, you know, everybody, you can't bring people in to help you. You know, I remember nights sitting up in the bed just praying, and his temperature, like I said, went to 107, and he was critical. And just praying and having that faith and that resilience and those roots that we have that have been given to us from our family, you know, from a child. My parents taught me, even though they didn't graduate from high school, they taught me the power of prayer. And that has been with me my entire life. They taught me the power of a great work ethic. They taught me the power of kindness. They taught me the power of being what it really means to be native and how to treat one another. And that's what you heard from Preacher Jacobs as well. So I could go on and on, but I'm going to stop there because I'm looking at these other two young people and I know they have a lot to add. So Zoe, I see you smiling. You want me to turn it over to you?
Sure. Everything that you said, Dr. LaClaire, was exactly what I was going to talk on. But I think something that I've really come to understand is being home and being with my family. Myself and my family, we live very, very, very busy lives. So in between sports practices and going to culture classes and from here and there, we really hadn't had a chance to, you know, sit down and enjoy a dinner together at the dinner table or, you know, have our family devotion before bedtime. And this whole experience through COVID has really connected our family and truly allowed me to understand that, you know, as I'm moving on to like my collegiate career, higher education, moving away from this house, you know, these are the moments right now that I'm gonna, you know, miss most. And so that sense of family, that sense of community that I've been able to like, been able to come into more over this time, even though I haven't been able to go and have be in person for NCNEO meetings or, you know, have our NASA meetings at school or be able to hang out with other people. Just knowing that they're there, we're all in this together. And that resiliency right there, that strength and that bonding power is something that I've really seen develop. And it's been a positive thing that's come out of our whole entire COVID experience.
And I'll thank you both. I'll echo that as well and just say that it's definitely everything that everyone has already said. I believe a lot of us share those same sentiments because for any Native person, family is just everything because throughout history, so many people have been just split up or not able to be with their family. So when Native people are able to just be together, our powwows, I know we have all missed them. Sure, we love the virtual powwow because it's great to still be able to see it, but that's like our homecoming. So for many of us that are not there, whether you have separate events or not, the powwow is like just something a lot of us missed. One thing that I definitely can add that I believe has shown is the fact that our people are very creative and have a very strong sense of ingenuity and innovation because in COVID, everyone has had to band together and it shows how we are able to help one another. So you see youth helping our elders learn what Zoom is because some people don't know what Zoom is or text or voice teleconference, anything to be able to see their families because they haven't been able to. So we have always, as Native people, created things that often other people took credit for and didn't want to give our people credit for, or often had times where there were things in history that were kind of just taken away from us in general, as we all know, like not just things from lives and things that we use for livelihood, but creative things. And so this time has shown us how creative we still are, reminded people that Native people continue to do amazing things no matter what, no matter where we are and what we face. So that sense of family and community, I say it all the time when people ask how I do things that I do, and I say, because I have a praying mama, a praying family, and my roots are strong in the fact that I know no matter where we go or what we do, our community is always with us. So I always remember and take my community and my tribal citizens and ancestors with me in my heart, much like all of you, because we're only here today because of what they did for us. And I think COVID has reminded us just how valuable life is, how important it is to move forward in faith, and how important it is that we have to support each other. We always send a message of that we're still here. Well, we're still here together because we've worked together. And I think that this has reminded us all of our strong roots of being a family and one community and one Native nation, even though we have different tribes, we're all Native people. So I've seen that a lot.
Okay, one of the things, and you've alluded a lot to the COVID, but I do want to ask this specific question. What are you hopeful for as we continue to navigate these changing times? It looks like, you know, it's been a year. It looks like we know our COVID numbers are better. We know the vaccinations are going to help I'm praying that it does. I've had my first dose and actually looking forward to getting my second dose. So what are you hopeful for as we continue to navigate, even though the COVID still has not left the building quite yet? Dr. Connie?
Well, I'm hopeful that we'll soon be back face-to-face. I have received my first shot as well, and I was excited about getting my first shot, and I'll get the second one in a couple of weeks. And I'm hoping that we'll be back face-to-face soon. But I also hope that we will take what we have learned during this time and utilize it. What we realize is that we can, as Joshua and Zoe said, we can think outside the box. And we've had to think outside the box. For our programming, in our program, we have 28 youth development specialists. And I just have to take time always and give a shout out to them because, you know, when COVID hit, I had to think outside the box of how we were going to still provide programming because we're receiving federal funds. And we had to think, how are we still going to apply this funding and make sure that we are meeting the demands and the regulations that are set forth in this federal grant? And when you're receiving federal money, you better make sure you're dotting every I and crossing every T. And so I had to start really thinking about how we were going to utilize this. And I came up with some different things and shared that with our staff. And I tell you what, our youth development specialists really jumped on the ball as they started doing this. We provided our culture academies that we usually have face-to-face here at our building. We provided them virtually. So we taught beadwork, we taught jewelry making, we taught pottery, and we taught drum and dance. And it was a little more difficult, and we didn't have as much participation, and a lot of that had to do with the fact that many of our students were sitting on virtual platforms all day, and they just didn't want to come back that afternoon after school hours to get on virtual platforms again. But we still had several students that took part of this. So what I plan and what I vision is that we're going to still utilize this virtual platform, because some of our students that live on the other end of the county, it's difficult for them to get here, but if we offer this virtual platform, we can still be able to provide programming for them. Our parents and our parent advisory council have still been part of our virtual meetings. So I'm hopeful that we'll still utilize the virtual platforms. The other thing I'm hopeful will come out of this and is an increase in equitable opportunities. COVID has really highlighted the lack of equity across the state. We've been screaming lack of equity, lack of equity, lack of equity. But when you start giving hotspots, when the governor sent the hotspots down, which was wonderful, and districts were buying Chromebooks to pass out to students, they have a Chromebook and they have a hotspot, but they don't have broadband. So you're defeating the purpose with a Chromebook and a hotspot. So it really has highlighted the lack of equity across the state. And so I'm hoping that now, that lack of equity will really be highlighted, not only as it relates to digital equity, but when it comes to other areas such as medicine, such as healthy eating. A lot of our folks, due to COVID, I don't know about you, but a lot of people have what we're calling it now is this COVID weight, because people are not out exercising and they're not eating as healthy as they should. And so there is really a lack of equity in many areas. And according to the First Nations Development Institute, 54% of American Indian and Alaska Native populations live in rural areas, and 68% live on or near their tribal lands. So when you're looking at these rural communities, that's where you have the lack of broadband. And so even though you're giving us a hotspot, and I appreciate that, and this is no disrespect to our governor by any means, because it has to do with towers. It has to do with companies building the infrastructure for broadband. So, and I think that he's really trying to work on that. But those are some areas that I hope will come out of this.
Zoe, will you chime in?
Yeah, sorry. Something that I've really noticed, especially in my youth population or Native youth population, is the amount of kind of interest that they have in connecting with others, especially during through our Kahari culture class. I've noticed a huge amount of interest in getting back to our, you know, traditional crafts. Last week, I think our craft box they sent out, we were making little chains, little wristlets, we even made chokers. So something that I'm really hoping to see a huge burst of out of this pandemic is more interest and more involvement in activities in our tribal engagements and activities that we have. I've seen in the way that we've implemented technology using Facebook to reach people, using Zoom to connect, even Instagram and Snapchat for more of my generation, things like that that are being handed to us and are available for our use. I'm excited to see how we as Native people implement that in reaching others, especially Native youth right now that have going through a hard time, being isolated, not having that sense of social connection, not having, you know, that academic enrichment or not having that cultural enrichment that we're used to, and coming out of this and being able to implement both technology and, you know, cultural identity, that's something that I'm excited to see happen in the near future.
And I echo that as well in a lot of sense, but in a different way, I'd like to see the continued flexibility that we've seen come out of this. We have learned more than ever where there were times when people would say, I don't have time to do anything. I think in some ways, the Creator has showed us that, well, when you don't have time, we're going to make you make time to make time for the things that matter. And your family should matter, your community, your tribal roots, and everyone that are a part of your life matter. So where little things as simple as people say, I've heard some people mention, well, there's no common cold anymore. There's no flu or there's no any other thing. Well, it's still out there, but we are following practices now that once people kind of frowned upon, for example, touching our face, something we all do a million times a day, or remembering to cover your mouth when you cough, or you know, things like that that are protecting us, and washing your hands more. I mean, I probably say we all wash our hands, hopefully, through each time when we're supposed to, but I bet you now there is not a single person that I've talked to who has not washed their hands more now in their life than they ever have in the past year. So that's why we have seen the change in the down spark of a lot of like disease and other things that have been an issue. But these have been things that our people knew about for a long time because we survived in the wilderness. We knew how to weather things that were going on. And so I would like to see that continued ingenuity and flexibility in the sense that people are banded together to help their elders. You've seen the younger generations and the elders come together more now than ever. I'd like to see that continue because there shouldn't be where the excuse often is, well, you know, I never learned how to do that. Well, if someone's willing to help and show you, and a lot of youth are, they just are afraid sometimes to approach an elder or don't necessarily know the right way to say it, respectfully spend time with those people and say, I'll be happy to show you. And I know, and I say spend time when it's safe, but you know, I spent time with different family members on Zoom where it would cut on and off a million times because they weren't sure how to get it to work. I might see part of their face. I might see a blank screen until we worked it out. And I'd like to see that same sense of patience that we've had to develop because oftentimes, and there's a saying that I heard growing up, be careful when you pray for patience because you just might get it and it might be in a way that you don't want it. So be specific in your prayer. And so for me, I've always taken that to heart when my mom and dad had said it to me. And I don't know that, of course, this pandemic hopefully didn't come and pray for patience, but we've certainly learned patience because we've had to be patient with ourselves because we had to learn how to do things differently and also be patient with other people. And whether that's people your same age or your elders or people younger than you. And the thing is, I would like to see people continue to be patient, continue to be compassionate towards one another and understanding, normalizing the fact that sometimes life happens. And the pandemic is certainly an example of that. Life can come out of nowhere and change in an instant. And tomorrow is never promised. So I would like to see people still loving one another the way they've learned to love during this pandemic and cherishing what it means to be a part of not only your community and your family, but people in the world in general. So, you know, they always say a smile or telling someone hello or asking them how their day is doing doesn't cost a thing. it may cost a little time and the energy you say it, but it can change somebody's entire day. And I can promise you that you may not know who you speak to at times when this pandemic has been going on, what they're going through, because no one's going to tell you everything that's going through their head. But you can brighten their day sometimes with something as simple as a smile. And so I'd like to see that same sense of compassion as well in so many areas, and just people realizing that, to, again, because we work together to fight this virus, think about how many other things that we could work together to accomplish to just get better over time. It took us a little while to figure out, well, how do you put all the people in one place and who's in charge and how do you do that with so many things? And I know it was stressful, and people can criticize different leadership and say, you know, they may have not done it the way they did it, but at the end of the day, this was new for everyone. It was something that in this generation, people had not dealt with on this scale, especially something that crippled technology and sent everybody home from school and work in a way that has never happened. So it tested our strength. So that last thing I would like to say is the strength that we gained from this to realize that we can persevere. And again, resilience, that same thing that has been brought up throughout this conversation and the previous, keep that and share that with other people and continue to remain unselfish and realize that, again, together as Native communities, we can help one another and we can continue to change things in the world if we work together and use those same principles that we've been reminded of.
Thank you so much. You guys are just full of wisdom. You pretty much have answered the questions. I did want to just sort of have you to elaborate a little bit on this one. Within your respective field, how have you seen things change as a result of COVID? I know Dr. Connie mentioned what she had to do with her YDS folks, but if you would just expand on that just a little bit.
I would just say that what we had to do is we had to change the way our programming took place. Before, as I said, we were had these kids face-to-face. Now we had to have Zoom meetings, or we had to have Google Meets, and we had to bring them in. And it was so important to have this conversation with our students. And I want to stop there a minute, not only for that, but that's not the YDS, but teachers and everyone. And I want to go back to something that Josh said, and I had written it down, so we're all on the same page here. But you know, teachers, this pandemic has changed for everyone. It's been a paradigm shift for everyone, not just one entity, but for everybody, for parents, for students, for educators, for everyone. And, you know, when we have teachers, I've had parents call and say, you know, my child can't get online today, and I only have enough internet for them to get on, get the information and get off. And then the next one's got to get on and get off. Or I had a parent that called one time and said that she had 5 children and she is working during the day. So her oldest 2 children, who one's in high school, one was in middle, it was like one was in high school, 2 were in middle, and the other ones were like elementary and a baby. So she has 5 children. Those oldest children, guess what they have become? They've become daycare providers because she has no choice but to work his work or not be fed. And so she's saying, you know, my children, I have to rely on them. And when you look at how this has changed and how it's impacted what we're doing, it's impacted everybody. I mean, parents can't pay for daycare. You have some parents that can say, okay, school shut down, I'm gonna send all 3 of my children to daycare. I know, I'm just wanna speak for what I know. My daughter had to send both of her children to daycare. She had one in school and one at daycare. Her daycare bill went from $500 to $1,000 a month. And you think about a parent that's got 5 children, they can't do that. And they're living paycheck to paycheck. And so what our youth development specialists have been doing, they have been going, calling these children, finding out, calling mom, you didn't log on today. We need to make sure you're logging on. Or we have children that for instance, we may have a child that sleeps late, and so they miss first period, and they're marked absent. As we had a meeting today, and this came up, they miss first period, and they're marked absent all day, even though they showed up for second, third, and fourth. So going back to teachers, going back to parents, being that liaison, trying to make sure that this child's not being marked absent, trying to make sure that we're putting things in place to make sure these children are going to be successful and a way to help them. And I want to say this on behalf of teachers and educators and parents and students and everybody. Going back to what Josh said earlier, and I have this written out on a piece of paper here. We need to give everybody a little bit of grace. You know, we want grace for ourselves when we mess up, but sometimes we don't want to extend that grace or that olive branch to everybody else. We need to give parents a little bit of grace. We need to give children a little bit of grace. You know, and I know Zoe can speak to this. For some students, this has been an easy transition. And I think that's great because some kids love online. And I'll be honest with you, I have taught online before. And it is much more difficult than teaching face-to-face. Because, you know, if you're in a classroom and one person asks a question, you may answer that question. But if you're in a virtual platform, somebody may send you that question, then somebody may send you the same question later, and somebody may send you the same question or variation of that question, and you're constantly preparing to meet everybody's needs. And it is much more difficult. And I think sometimes there have been conversations that people make the assumption that teachers or educators haven't made now because we're working from home. This has been a lot. I'll be honest with you. I have worked harder since COVID than I have ever worked, trying to ensure that everybody's on task, trying to ensure that programming is being implemented with fidelity, trying to ensure that everybody's doing what they're, and the YDS are the same way. Our youth development specialists, they have worked harder trying to get children back in school, trying to make sure that they're not quitting school. We have children, some children that have gone to work, high school students. And $300 or $400 may not be a lot to us, but when you have a child that's not making anything and they've gone to making $300 or $400, that's a lot of money. And so now they're trying to decide, is it worth my time going back to work? I mean, going back to school, or should I? I'm just going to continue with work. And so we're trying to bridge that gap. So it has been very difficult. And the other thing is we all have our own. And my daughter said this to me years ago, and I kind of try to stick to this. Sometimes it's better to assume the best. And what that does is not only help you, help the other person because you're not judging them so hard, but it's good for your mental health. Because sometimes we have these assumptions that people aren't working or people aren't doing this, and then we get all upset about stuff that we can't even handle. But I think sometimes if we're not careful, our perception becomes our reality. So it's better to assume the best so we have a better perception than to think of people in negative, because I think every one of us are working hard. Every one of us have gone to a different level. Even our students, you know, I've had students that say to me in my parent committee meetings, you know, I really need you to pray for me. I'm struggling. I'm really struggling. And so we're trying to reach out to them. We're trying to provide that social emotional well-being, develop those relationships back. And it's been a tough time. And I could go on and on, but I'm going to stop. But, you know, I just want us all to give, as Joshua said, give everybody a little bit of grace.
Yeah, so especially this past year has been very tough for a lot of students. And myself personally, trying to balance, you know, soaking in those last senior moments through the computer screen it's been unlike any other experience in my life where I've had to truly, you know, just hold on, pray, and just see where the Lord's going to take me, because not being able to see my friends at school, or, you know, having to struggle with a calculus test online that I haven't been able to talk to my teacher in the past 2 days because I've had to work during her class, or her office hours haven't worked, or my computer is messed up, my Wi-Fi, all of these things culminating on top of students being in the midst of a global pandemic has been truly roughing the storm. And throughout the whole past year, I've just learned that I've got to take it as it comes, because the The future is unknown. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. So I've got to do my best right now. And I think a lot of students have kind of come into that mindset as we've hopefully round the end of the hump of the pandemic. But at the beginning of the year, getting used to this new technological landscape, everything online, abruptly having our year cut in the middle of March last year, and not knowing when I'm going to see my friends again, not knowing when, is this my last time at school, or am I automatically a college freshman now? I'm in the middle of my junior year. That unpredictability has been kind of hard to navigate and balance. But one thing that I have learned, and that's truly come out of this pandemic, that I've learned from COVID-19 is that you have to embrace the unpredictability. And that, especially with pandemic and with COVID, and even outside of COVID, things that happen to you or happen for a reason. And this has taught me to be strong, to be resilient, to know my worth, and to know the value that I put into the things that I do, and know how strong I am. Because there's no way that I could have gotten through this school year, this pandemic, if it wouldn't have been for my family, if it wouldn't have been to, you know, reaching out to one of my friends or my teachers and knowing that we're all in the same boat together. And that this has been tough for everybody, especially students, especially my Nicknayo family, where we haven't been able to have our in-person meetings, but, you know, we've been resilient and we've been adaptable, and we've learned to know that we can have Zoom meetings and we can still plan this conference, even though it's online this year, and we can still have engagement opportunities, even though they're online. And that has just been something that I've really embraced, I've held on to as my rock, and being able to, you know, watch drive-in services or Facebook live streams from church, having that connection through my faith in Jesus Christ, that has been, you know, my solid foundation throughout this whole time, and culminating that with my native heritage, my identity, and my, you know, academics. So just the lessons and everything that I've learned throughout this time, something that students are holding on to now, I think that's really important as we keep continuing on in our journeys.
Zoe, I also agree with you when it comes to school. So the class of 2020 graduated in the middle of this pandemic. At my last semester of law school, was Zoom School of Law, as we call it. And now that's the new normal for all students and educators to an extent, unless they sometimes go in to be able to teach where they are on a Zoom platform. But at the same time, it's not the same, but people have adjusted. There was virtual graduations. And I know a lot of people that graduated in 2020 shared the same sentiment that I did. When you work 3 years, 4 years, or however long your degree program is, you wait all that time to just say, when I can walk across that stage and you want mom and daddy and your friends and your family and everybody you know to see you and cheer you on. But a lot of people, you know, we know that that was taken in a sense from us, but it wasn't, because that accomplishment, like I've reminded people, you still accomplished it. All that was a symbolism of what you have done when you walked across that stage. And for me, specifically in my field, I had to take the bar exam in the middle of the pandemic, actually in person, because in North Carolina, they did not do it virtually for the July 2020 bar exam. So I had a mask on like everyone else when we took the exam for 8 hours, well, almost 10 hours counting the 1 hour break you get, 2 days in a row, where I don't know about y'all, but when you wear the mask, sometimes you're gonna sweat a little bit more. You certainly don't always breathe the same. And certain aspects for me anyway, when I'm nervous, I breathe more, sweat more. And so a couple of times I just kept praying under my breath and saying, you know, God, please just help me to have the oxygen levels that I need in my brain and mind, because I was convinced that at times that, you know, maybe it's just because I'm not breathing as well or something along those lines. It was a challenge, but I did pass by the grace of God. And someone asked me about it, I always say, you know, that prayer got me there, and the people that supported me, the same thing for everyone else, and the same for all graduates. So nothing was lost in having to not walk across the stage, because your accomplishment, whatever it was, whatever you did, whether it was high school, whether it was law school, whether it was a graduate program, undergrad, it doesn't matter. Whether it was a certificate program, it's yours. You earned it. And it is an amazing accomplishment for you, for your ancestors, for our people, for all Native people. I posted a statistic the other day that is alarming, that I want people to know all the time, that of the over a million attorneys that exist in the United States, only approximately 0.02 to 0.03% are Native American. And I'm one of the people that make it a point to continue to bring that statistic up, but to help encourage others that if you're interested in law, go to law school, because people like myself and others, we have programs and things that we're working on to attempt to help others, because we don't know many people that are necessarily attorneys that are Native American. There are some that we can reach out, but there needs to be more in that field, because having a seat at the table is so important. So in my field, that has been a part of the impact. And also virtual has also came into the courtroom. So I don't know, hopefully no one's had any tickets or anything lately, but I can tell you that they kept getting continued for a lot of people. That's mental distress that people went through to have to say, I thought I was gonna get rid of this ticket. Now it's been pushed a few months. So by the time you got there, some judges in some sense probably thought, well, I know you went through a lot to get here, but let's figure out what we're going to do with this ticket. And hearings have been virtual. That has been an adjustment for my field, because while it may be similar, you see TV where people are arguing in the courtroom, I promise you the television gives you a lot of inaccuracies when it comes to law, because there aren't people that can just run in at the last minute and save the day unless they want to get charged some kind of fine for not disclosing that expert witness that they had out of nowhere. But I say that to say it was an adjustment, because you had to learn to be more concise. You had to learn how to produce documents that were condensed, because whereas you could have these thick trial notebooks that might have 100 or so pages in them for a trial, you were not gonna have that with these virtual hearings. Virtual hearings, as the courts open back up, it may change, but you might get some judges for certain types of cases that you have a protocol for 5 pages, some for 10. So you need to make the best case for your client in a very small amount of time and say it in the most direct and concise way possible. But I also saw, as I was looking at that, the issues that continue to be highlighted with social justice and equity in general. That is very big among our people, because what I have seen in throughout law school and knew even before law school and even now is that oftentimes our people are subjected to plea bargains that are not good for them, because they cannot afford legal representation, or they don't have an ability to be able to get some access to people who can help them. Or in some instances, they have people who are not sensitive to the needs of what are specific to Native American people. For example, we have issues with higher amounts of addiction problems and things that may happen where we didn't have the education from elders and things like that passed down that we may not know, or certain things may not be okay in some places that are legal in others, you name it. There's a lot of things, but the access piece is big. In my home community, for example, in Hollister, I, from my tribe, I'm approximately the third attorney from our tribe. And so it's a big deal, because while there are three of us, I'm the only one that is currently in North Carolina that can help. And I offer my services pro bono as counsel to our tribe, and also help a lot of people with family law issues and other things, because even before the pandemic, there were issues with access to social justice and the law in general to get what you needed. But it highlighted it even more that now, how do I get it? So you see a lot of WebMD, and then there's Zoom Law where people use to find things. And I would just say that while, you know, we teach people to look for themselves, definitely don't ever use that to self-diagnose or to get your own legal advice. Seek an actual licensed attorney to get the best advice, and realize that there are resources out there and people that are willing to help on a pro bono basis with different things. And even if not, they will direct you to resources at times that can. And I'm one of those people that I'm willing to help where I can, and will certainly direct you where I can, to realize that we want to make sure you're getting the access that you need, and that you're not taking an actual plea. And when I say a plea bargain, you're pleading to say, I didn't do exactly what you said, or I did something similar, but I'm going to take a much lesser charge for it. Or some people choose jail because they'd rather do that, not realizing the implications later when you plead guilty. Sometimes you can't get certain grants, can't get certain educational opportunities, certain jobs, when if you didn't really commit the crime or didn't do something, then don't settle because someone else told you something that is not the best thing for you to do. And so I say that to say, like, the legal field can be complicated, but at the end of the day, it's more of an access thing that people need to get the justice that they need. And for me, I will continue to provide that justice in every way I can, adjust it to virtual hearings. And while none of us like Zoom School of Law or like not celebrating that moment the way we would have liked, I'm thankful to know that I'm still doing what I wanted to do. I'm still able to be a successful attorney because I adjusted, I adapted, and I just used that same force and prayers that came from my family and my community to get where I am. And so definitely, I know Leslie posted the link for Indigenous Pathways of Law. If you know youth that are interested or people that I went back to school at the age of 29, as my mama always told me, it's never too late to do what you want to do. My mom graduated with her second degree at the age of 50 when I graduated from high school. So I say that to say, when I started telling myself, you know, I'm too old, I can't do it, that my mom said, nope, let me remind you, remember how old I was. And so I finally did it. So if you know people interested, go check out our Facebook page. If you don't want to go to law school, you can still support others and be there along with them throughout the journey. And also maybe learn some things, because sometimes we plan to do workshops and things just to give general knowledge. So while the legal field has changed a lot because of the pandemic, we're rolling with it because we want to make sure that justice and equal access to things continue to improve. And as long as I am alive, it is definitely my goal to continue to help as much as possible for our people and anyone to get what they need, especially in that area.
Thank you so much. I have one last question, and then I think Dr. Leslie has a question that someone posted on Facebook. Our last question, what is one piece of advice that you would like to share with those joining us, or maybe your last piece of advice that you want to share?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that question? My headphones are not working.
What is one piece of advice that you would like to share with those joining us, or piece of advice that you would like to leave with everybody?
Okay. I would like to share that this is service work. We are servants. This is service work. And Jesus said it best in Matthew 23:11, he that is greatest among you shall be the servant. What we are doing, we're all trying to do our best. Sometimes we get everything right and sometimes we don't. And we'll go back to what I said earlier. I would love for everybody to extend a little bit of grace to each one of us. This has been a difficult time for a lot of people, but I think that the theme for this goes right along with what we said earlier, resiliency. We have shown that we are resilient. We have shown that we can adapt to change. And we have been doing that for many, many years. I am a mathematician. That's my background. And a lot of times when I talk to students about STEM careers and I ask them to draw a scientist, they always draw a Caucasian male in a lab coat. They never think of someone that looks like me, someone that looks like them, if they're native, or someone of color. And I'm trying to share with them that, yes, that could be you. As Joshua said earlier, that attorney could be you. As someone said earlier, when I grew up, I think it was Leslie posted, when I grew up, I want to be like Zoe. And we want our young children to believe that they can do anything. I shared with everybody earlier that I am the first person in my family to graduate from high school, the first person to attend college. But as a result of that, I am the one, I guess, that God allowed to pave the way for the rest of my family. My sister is a educator. I have a sister who's a nurse. Both of my children have graduated from college. One's in the master's program now. The second one has graduated with her advanced degree in counseling and her master's in administration. And my husband will graduate in 8 weeks with his theology degree. So it's just paving that way. And the advice I would like to share is that, you know, I just think that as we grow older, let us not forget those people that paved the way for us. When I think of where I am today, I think of all of the ancestors. I think of women like Agnes Chavis, who fought for Indian education when it wasn't popular. I think of the those our ancestors that paved the way for UNCP to be here today. I think about all of those. So I'm not here by just some accident. I'm here because God put someone in my path that directed me in this direction. And may we all, another thing I would like to say is may we do everything with humbleness and with grace. You know, we are only what we are, as Joshua said earlier, by the grace of God. It is because of him and him alone. And at the end of the day, and I mean, when I mean the end of the day, I don't mean the end of Friday. I mean the end of life. It really doesn't matter how much money you made. It really doesn't matter how many degrees you had. It really doesn't matter all the things that you accomplished in life. What really matters is that you loved and that you knew him. And if you know him, it'll be easy to love. And so the piece of advice I would give to everyone is may we always have a servant's heart. And let the greatest among you, let him be the servant. Jesus humbled himself, the greatest of all, humbled himself and washed his disciples' feet. I mean, you're thinking about people when they walked, imagine how those feet looked. And he humbled himself and he washed his disciples' feet. Oh, I'm telling you, that brings tears to my eyes every time I think of that. And every time something comes my way and I get frustrated and aggravated about it, my husband said this to me years ago, and it's just a constant reminder. I was sharing with him about a situation I was going through and I was so frustrated about it. And he said, but Connie, you're no greater than the Lord. You're no greater than the Lord. So if they loved him, they'll love you. If they hate you, they hated him, they'll hate you. If he's going to be mistreated, you're going to be mistreated. And so may we always, and I think that goes back to being Native people. May we always honor our elders. May we always respect them. And may we always be the servant. Thank you.
Wow, Dr. Connie, just hearing you speak, I'm just so thankful to be here with Mr. Richardson and Dr. Locklear today. You guys have truly been role models in my young life. I'm looking up to both of you and all the other elders and tribal community leaders here. I just want to thank you all for allowing me to speak today. But one piece of advice that I would be able to give if anyone wants to listen to it was to embrace your power, especially as Native students walking in two worlds, having to balance, staying connected to your cultural roots while also pursuing that education and PWIs primarily. It can be kind of hard to, truly understand and connect to who you are and understand that your position where you're at is where you're meant to be. And one thing that my father, my dad, and my mom have always told me is just because someone like you isn't in that position doesn't mean someone like you shouldn't be there. It just means maybe that's where you're meant to be. And as that has been one thing that I've kept at the forefront as I've tried to pursue and get myself, help my community in the world as I push for my academics, I advocate for my tribe. I lift up and encourage my other fellow youth to do the same because wherever I go, whatever I do, my culture is right there with me. My Native identity is right there alongside with me. And that's what I hope to inspire other people to do. And I just, there's something so special about embracing who you are. And that is so important for us Native youth to understand and to keep hold on to keep in the forefront of our minds as we navigate outside of COVID and pushing into this new normal that we're in, because it's even more so important to represent our people and to represent the diverse background and beautiful heritage that we have. Because we need to help others. We need to help our fellow youth rise up. And the only way that us as Native youth are able to do that through leaders is by doing the same for our other people. So we have to, as the next generation of leaders, we have to lead others not only in our path, but help them and raise them up as the same, and even more so culturally connected at the same time.
Wow, both of you have shared such powerful messages. Well, who knew that, like, how powerful it would be for us all to hear each other, and that, you know, the Lord's purpose of us being on this panel together, because we're in sync. And I have always been a firm believer. I believe, Zoe, you said it, and Dr. Locklear as well, about that all things happen for a reason. I am not a person that necessarily believes in luck or chance. I believe in divine appointments, always have and always will believe that what's meant for you is for you. So advice that I give that has always been true to me and stayed true in my heart is that it's never too late to find your purpose and walk into your purpose. Because whatever you're meant to do, every single person has a purpose in this world. God created you for a reason. You're here for a reason, and there's something for you to do. Every day you wake up, you have a renewed purpose, another chance, another opportunity to do something different, to make an impact for yourself, for others, whatever it is, you were given another opportunity. I know many times people will say, well, I have tomorrow. Well, we all know tomorrow's not promised, and we all know that we have to seize the moment to go after what we want and what we need. But finding your purpose, sometimes you can be in, you know, older as an elder, or you could be younger when you find it. It doesn't matter as long as you actually are seeking it. And I would say seeking the Creator's guidance in that is how you find that. You sit down. Our people are champions of meditation, champions of sitting down and with nature and listening, because we understand that the messages and the things that we need are already there for us. We just have to listen and open up to what God is trying to show us. Oftentimes when I'm frustrated, especially now with the pandemic, when things don't always go our way, I'll sit down and I'll say, you know, just take a moment to breathe and pray and ask God to just show me, what is it that I need to learn from this? What is it that I need to do? And so I would say, and a piece of advice and a challenge to everyone is, if you haven't done it, which I'm sure many of us have done some level of reflection, would be to sit down, connect back with these roots that are part of who you are. Remember where you came from, because surely not a single person here today is where they were years ago or when they started out. Whether it might be one step you've taken, 20, 100, or however far you've come this far again by faith, and you've come this far because you have a purpose. So whatever the story is, every day you have the opportunity to put pen to paper in your life, to write another chapter, another page, another part of the story, to tell someone else your story, because your story is your story, but your story might just be the story that saves somebody else's life. It might be the story that helps somebody else find what they need. It might be the story that helps our people continue to go to the next level and get in these meeting spaces and have a seat at the table where we haven't before. We know now that we have people in congressional seats that are our people, that more than ever opportunities are opening up. But that's because people have fought hard for those, and people have listened to the lessons of our ancestors and also listened to guidance from our Creator about things they need to do. And that's a part of walking in purpose. So the biggest thing that I always tell people is, remember that you can do anything that you set your mind to. Pray about it. Ask, how can I do it? Don't try to do it by yourself. Because one song that always sticks in my head when I think about when things get hard, and I think about the bar exam too, because I always try to tell myself, you can sit through that and make it. You can do anything. God reminds you every time. And we always all probably are guilty of saying, Lord, just help us through this, and worry about some things because we're human, and realize that God already brought us through something even worse before. This pandemic is probably the worst thing that anybody could have ever seen in many ways, because it touched so many parts of things. Just remember that whatever you face, we are coming through this, and we can make it through anything. Find your purpose, pray about it, walk into your purpose, and then take that serious. Be a champion of whatever your purpose is, and whatever that is, be proud of it, because you are who you are for a reason, and you're here for a reason, and that no matter where you came from, the places that you're going, you're meant to be there. So just thank God in advance for the great things coming your way, and continue to remember that you can and will do all things that you want to accomplish through Christ.
I'm going to say this before when I turn it, before Ms. Gwen takes over. You two have just inspired me so much that I'm looking forward to retirement, because there's going to be somebody like you guys take over. So I'm just excited about that. You know, we have some great inspirational young people. And every time I get to be in the presence of young people with this level of wisdom, it just inspires me. And I am just so honored that I had the pleasure to serve on this panel with you two. And I look forward to meeting you face to face and do the Indian thing. I just want to hug you. So let's do a virtual.
You are so absolutely right, Dr. Connie. I don't think we could have chosen a better panelist than the three of you. You definitely, the three of you have been in sync, that's for sure. I think Dr. Leslie has one Facebook question that was posed. Dr. Leslie?
Yes, and this one was for Zoe. So Zoe, Ms. K asks, our Native students are suffering from a lack of cultural identity connections during this time of quarantine. What are some suggestions to help ease this difficult season aside from using social media? Are there any other ways in which you've coped during this season?
Yes, so one thing that I'm very proud to admit that I've gotten closer with my family, but I've also gotten closer with the Lord, and that has helped me during this time, learning to put my problems, give all my problems to Him. When I'm feeling down, when I'm feeling stressed, when I'm feeling anxious, I give it all to Him. That is one thing that has truly turned this whole pandemic and my experience around. At the beginning of this, I had no idea how I was going to cope without, you know, being able to stay connected with Nickneo or be able to go to the high school and see my friends or, you know, that Friday night football game. Those are the things that were important to me. But now I have completely done a 180. I know the most important thing in my life is my relationship with Christ now. And I say that completely, 100% wholeheartedly unashamed. And I just want to, if anyone out there is struggling, if anyone is going through times that they don't see the future, they don't understand what's going on, how they can change their life, open up your Bible, start praying. It might not happen overnight. You might still feel alone, but the Lord's always there for you. If you can just turn to Him, everything will be okay. And you're going to still go through hard times. You're going to still feel anxious sometimes, but the Lord is right there. You're in His hands and He's got your whole life under control. And I say that if you're a student, if you're an 80-year-old woman, if you're a millennial, anyone out there that's going through a tough time, hand it over to the Lord.
Thank you so much, Zoe. Any last words from our panelists? I think you guys could just talk all afternoon, and it's been wonderful. Okay, thank you so much. We are now nearing 4 p.m. It's about 10 till, and we're scheduled to do the presentation of our Veterans Awards and Scholarship Awards at 4. But we have a short video. It's our juried art retrospective video that we want to share with you in between. And as soon as that's over, shortly after that, we will begin our presentation. Enjoy. What you have just witnessed during our juried art retrospective was many of those art pieces were art pieces that were actually part of the United Tribes Juried Art Show. I hope you enjoyed that. Next up, we have our presentation of our Veterans Awards, and that's going to be led by Mr. Greg Richardson, who is a member of the United Tribes Board, as well as the Executive Director of the North Carolina Commission of Indians. Hey, Greg.
Hello, Gwen. Just wanted to say, Gwen, I think we've got a dynamite lineup for the conference this year. I've just been listening to these presentations this afternoon. I am just deeply honored to be listening in on such dynamic words of wisdom. And it's just so wonderful to see these young people, especially taking part in the conference this year, and to just touching on so many issues that we all need to be concerned about, and especially bringing that into that spirituality that is just so, so important for all of us. So again, this year, United Tribes and the Commission of Indian Affairs, as has been tradition for a number of years right now, is to provide an opportunity as part of our program to recognize a number of veterans in North Carolina. So the process starts usually in the fall with word going out to the tribes, and we're asking tribes to nominate an American Indian veteran for the conference. So that has occurred. And so today we're going to be honoring them. And we have quite a lineup today. And so I'm going to proceed right now with the first award. The first award is going to a member of the Coharie Indian Tribe, Specialist Fourth Class Marty Simmons. He was with the United States Army from 1970 to 1972 and is a Vietnam veteran. We have a plaque that we will be presenting to Mr. Simmons at a later date. And we ask that all of our tribes have an honoring ceremony in their community, whether it's a tribal council meeting or at some other point when we have the powwows, to present these plaques to the individual veteran at that time. Today at 10 o'clock in Cherokee, North Carolina, the Eastern Band of Cherokee followed those instructions and had a ceremony at the ceremonial grounds at Cherokee. And this is where Lieutenant Lewis Harding was with the United States Army from 1957 to 1967, a Vietnam veteran. And he actually was given his plaque today at a ceremony at the Cherokee Tribal Ceremonial Grounds, that is up in Cherokee, North Carolina. So we're very proud that they took time out of their schedule to do that. Our next awardee is the Halawasa Pony Tribe, my tribe, is Calvin Lee Sankey Richardson, who grew up right down the road from me at the house. He was in the United States Army from 1971 to 1975. And he served in Thailand and in stateside. So we're very proud that the tribe honored him this way. The next honoree is the Lumbee Tribe of North Carolina. This is for Chief Petty Officer David Locklear, who was in the United States Army from 1965 to 1994. And he was also, is rather, a Vietnam veteran. The next awardee is with the Meherrin Tribe. Sergeant Major Roger Archer, who was with the United States Air Force from 1958 to 1986. He served in Japan, Germany, and Guam. Next up is a member of the Okanichi Band of Saponi Nation, Sergeant Bryce Watkins, Senior United States Army from 1967 to 1968. He was also a Vietnam veteran. Next is Saponi Indian Veteran Recognition for Robert Trent Epps, Specialist Fourth Class, served in the United States Army from 1958 to 1964, and is, of course, a Korean veteran. And in addition to the recognition today, we're also wanting everyone to remember our veterans some of our World War II veterans, there's not many left. And so when we have the veteran ceremonies, we want to always remember our veterans. Next awardee is from the Waccamaw Siouan tribe, Sergeant Michael Edward Jacobs, United States Army from 1967 to 1969. He is a Vietnam veteran and a Purple Heart recipient. We also recognize veterans from our urban organizations this year, and we have three to present nominees. And this is from the Cumberland County Association for Indian People, Corporal David Kamaka, served in the United States Marines from 1988 to 1995, served in Desert Shield and Desert Storm. Also, this was a veteran honoree, our only female or woman veteran from Guilford Native American Association. She is Staff Sergeant Deborah Jacobs Fitz, served in the United States Army Reserves from 1977 to 2006. She served in Iraq, in the Iraq Freedom and Desert Storm conflicts. And finally, I'm gonna let Gwen.
I'm gonna do this one last but not least. I'm sure you recognize this, Bella, from the Triangle Native American Association. They actually recognize Specialist Fourth Class Gregory A. Richardson, who served in the United States Army from 1971-1972, a Vietnam veteran. Congratulations, Greg.
Thank you, Gwen. And Gwen, that concludes our veteran awards for the 2021 Indian Unity Conference Veteran Ceremony. And I wanted to say a word or two about the chairman of our Veterans Committee, who is Mr. Sam Lambert from Eastern Band, and our chairman, Ricky Burnett, with the Commission of Indian Affairs. So we're so pleased to have our veterans recognized in this way before our United Tribes and Indian Unity Conference platform. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Greg. We're going to move right on into our 2021 United Tribes Scholarship awardees and recipients. And these are going to be presented by Ms. Hattie Campbell, who is our Waccamaw Siouan United Tribes representative. Ms. Hattie.
Oh, we're on, I think. Am I on?
We can hear you, Miss Hattie, but I can't see you.
Okay, let's start this again.
There we go.
Are we there?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to tell you about our scholarships awards. One of the major objectives of the United Tribes Board of Directors has been to generate funds to provide scholarships for our American Indian youth in North Carolina. We are proud of our track record. It is through the generous support of our advertisers, conference sponsors and attendees, tribes and organizations, and the hard work of the commitment of the United Tribes Board of Directors that these scholarships are available. It is with great honor, pride, and thankful hearts that we present these 17 outstanding Indian honorees to you. In the way of our Indian ancestors, as we honor them, we honor all our ancestors, our elders, you, our children, our grandchildren, and our children yet to come. To the scholarship recipients, past, present, and future, congratulations. And may you always remember that one day you will give back to your people as we have given and continue to give to you. May the Great Spirit bless each of you always during this 46th North Carolina Indian Unity Conference. We urge each of you to join with us as we remember the humble beginnings of education for Indian children in North Carolina. 134 years ago, with the Croatan Indian Normal School, As you excel and grow in your professional and personal life, remember to give back. I would like to thank our sponsors for this generous support. And again, I will start naming our scholarship recipients. Our first one is Great, and this will be given to our next one is Chief W.R. Richardson, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And this is our recipient is Lyric Locklear Lumbee. Our next one is Marcella Dean Green Jacobs, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And this is given to Chayton Moore Walkamore Suwan. Next one is Nanny Coleman Martin, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And the recipient is Kendall Woodell Lumbee. Our next one is Percy Richardson Memorial Scholarship. And the recipients are Evan Richardson, Halawa Saponi, Felicia Ward Lumbee, Frederick Locklear Lumbee. Our next one is Dr. Deidre Blanks, Fayetteville Ear, Nose, Throat, and Plastic Surgery. And the recipient of this one is Lydia Mansfield Lumbee. Our next one is Chief Jesse and wife Bertha Richardson, American Indian Memorial Scholarship Award. Percy Richardson, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And this one is given to Caitlin Deal, Miss Indian, North Carolina. Simone F. and Mrs. Maud Cummins, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And this is given to Tiana Lowry Lumbee. Our next one is the Walkamore Suwan Tribe American Indian Scholarship. And the recipient of this one is Tristan Locklear Lumbee. Our next one is Gervis Oxendine Scholarship to Promote Mathematics, sponsored by Dr. Olivia Holmes Oxendine. And the recipient is Zoe Locklear Coheri. Our sponsor for this one is Normie and Eileen Holmes Education Scholarship, sponsored by Dr. Olivia Holmes Oxendine. And this is given to Helena Lewis Lumbee. Our next sponsor is Corbin and Misha Eddins, District 8, Lumbee Tribe of North Carolina. And the recipient is Kirsten Locklear Lumbee. Our next sponsor is E.S. Jacobs, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And the recipient of this one is Abigail Whitfield Coheri. Our next sponsor is Chief Gabriel Renfield Memorial Scholarship, Walton Lumbee. Our next one is O.C. Martin, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And this is Braden Hunt Lumbee. It's given to Braden Hunt Lumbee. Our next sponsor is Mr. James R. and Roberta B. Mitchell, American Indian Memorial Scholarship. And this recipient of this is Carrington Harris Lumbee. I hope I didn't miss anyone. Okay, again, thanks to all the sponsors of these wonderful scholarships. If you would like to sponsor a scholarship next year, please contact us at united-tribes.org. And before I go, I would like to thank the United Tribes Board. And I would also especially thank Dr. Leslie Locklear, who has been our technician liaison. Thank you all for working to help get these scholarships that we have. Thank you, thank you. And we look forward to all these sponsors and some more next year. Thank you and have a good evening.
Thank you so much, Hattie. And congratulations to all of our sponsorship scholarship recipients. And thank you so very much to our sponsors. We definitely could not do it without you. Before we get off, Dr. Leslie is posting an evaluation in the chat. There's a link for it. And we would really, really appreciate you completing your evaluation for the conference. I want to thank again all of our guest speakers, all of our panelists. I just looked at you today as guest speakers as well, because you provided so much insight to what it is we actually, our theme and what we have been talking about the last couple of days. I want to give another huge shout out to Dr. Leslie Locklear. She's so much more than our technical liaison. She really has been our organization, our drive. She's set deadlines for us to get things in for our conference. And I think it has gone very, very smoothly, considering this was our first time actually doing it virtual. But a big shout out as well to all of you for attending, for taking time out of your day yesterday, and especially today on a Friday afternoon when the weather is so beautiful outside, but you have chosen to join us, and we are very, very much appreciative of that. Before we get off, we want to leave you with some wonderful, wonderful music by our current Miss Indian North Carolina, Caitlin Marie Deal. And she's going to leave you with some just beautiful, beautiful lyrics. And again, thank you for being here. Thank you for attending our conference. And hopefully, as they always say, Lord's willing, we'll see you at face-to-face next year. Haven't decided where yet, but hopefully somewhere next year soon. Thank you. Caitlin.
Hey, everybody. Thank you so much for joining our conference. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. I'm going to sing for you a couple of my favorite hymns to end off our beautiful conference, and I'm asking my dad, Preacher Bobby Deal, to accompany me with his acoustic guitar. I hope y'all enjoy it.
When we first began.
that I'm going to sing. We sang at the conference last year, and I hope you enjoy it. It's called How Great Thou Art. I told you the wrong name. How Great Thou Art. Is that Andrew?
Concludes our 2021 North Carolina Indian Unity Conference. We hope you have enjoyed, and we will see you next year. Bye.